Alive.
What's happening, people? I'm here with the main man.
It's the champ. Make
sure you tune into Pep Talk UK, where it's talking boxing and
big up.
Thank you, AJ. Oi, oi, welcome to the Pep Talk UK Sports Podcast, the podcast that talks the major boxing and football news from around the globe, real points of view from a real panel, hashtag real talk on Pep Talk. Please subscribe to Pep Talk UK on iTunes and YouTube. Don't forget to like, share and comment. Now, I'm your host, Frankie B, and I'm joined by a sick panel. Firstly, I'd like to welcome from the capital city of France, Paris, but now a resident in the home counties, is Pascal. How are ya?
Oui. I'm very, very well, Frankie B. How are you?
I'm doing well, mate. I've just come back from the Hay and Bellevue presser, mate. Fairly subdued, mate. I was surprised. No tables thrown, no chairs, nothing.
No Simpson reference to Sancho Bob's or anything like that?
Nothing, mate. They were pretty cordial. It was a bit quiet. You know, I was really surprised. It was getting heated at one stage, but really, I was quite disappointed with that presser, mate. You know?
Oh, but it's such a shame because if you remember the first time they met, David Hay was talking all of that good stuff, you know? And unfortunately, he left it all in the ring. But you know, I'm looking forward to the rematch. I think it'll be interesting. It's certainly, David Hay has a lot to lose, you know?
Hey, for me, both fighters are going to be the winners because the money they're going to pull in from that box office, mate, that means some nice, luxurious holidays, mate.
Of course. You know, I can see. You remember when I met Tony Bellew for JD Sports Undefeated, he was wearing a very nice Gucci jacket, so I'm sure he's going to buy a few more of those.
Yeah, you know that. He's popping tags like that now. Right, Pascal, we're going to keep it moving. Got a busy show ahead. Do you want to shout out your social media, brother?
Well, bien sûr, my social media is very simple. I'm on Instagram and Twitter. Follow me, Pascal_DeSade, Twitter, Instagram. Merci.
Yeah, the bad mouth of Paris. Right, next up is a man who has his own YouTube channel, Truth and Facts Boxing. It's Bo, H2OV. Bo, how you doing, my G?
Man, doing good. Always talking boxing with my boys from across the town over there, with my man, with my man and my dog from France, Pep Talk UK, man. You guys get it in, love it.
It's all good, man. I understand you're in South America smoking that la la la.
Yeah, I'm smoking. I took a puff or two, you know what I'm saying? Not enough to show up on the drug test, you know. I'm trying to do a Luis Ortiz style.
That was his medication, man.
Right, yeah.
Cool. So, what's going on with the channel? More good content that you're uploading on YouTube?
Man, a lot of good content, man. I've been able to do like 2 to 3 videos a day now. I upgraded my my equipment for making movies, so I can make two and three at a time, put them on my phone and upload them as I go along my day. And just, you know, it's been great, man. I've been 1 year, got almost 400 subscribers. Wow. And just this summer alone, I picked up 250 new subscribers. So, man, it's been great. I love it. And it's, you know, it's, what can I say, man? One day I'll be as famous as Pep Talk, though. You know what I'm saying? You guys are famous, man. You guys stood by Anthony Joshua, man, before he was king.
Bro, we're still working, bro. You know, but you know what? support Truth and Facts Boxing, because Bo knows his boxing. You know, he's about that boxing life.
That's right, man. That's right.
All good. Now, Bo, you want to shout out your social media before we move on?
Oh yeah, man. Follow me at Truth and Facts About Boxing. Of course, you got me, Bo, and you got my guy, Bernard Detective B. He'll be out there looking for missing fighters. He dropped some tips. You can also catch me at Capital T for Truth _ Capital F for Fact Box 1 on Twitter. And same thing on Instagram, lowercase Truth and Facts About Boxing. And you can also catch me with my boys from The Movement. That's 2K from Prodigy of Boxing, Big Cool from Colossal Boxing, Juan Devon Liberty, and my partner in crime, Detective B. And you can also, that's DAMUBMENT. And you can also follow us on Instagram, where we do the uploads for the skits as well.
Cracking stuff. You're done, though. Right. Finally, I'd like to welcome a man that will fight this weekend at York Hall. It's the Supreme Talent. It's the welterweight. It's Chris Too Slick Congo, my brother. How you doing?
Yes, I'm good, man. I'm great. Can't be better, man.
Yeah, you had a hard day at training?
Nah, this week is just chilled out, man. Obviously, Monday, just done a little 3 miles and went to the gym, do a bit of pad sessions. Didn't do nothing yesterday. Today, very light, a few pads, touching up pads. That's it, man. Tomorrow, we've got a media workout. Friday, weighing, man. All the hard work was done last week, man. All the sparring with Chris Eubank Jr. and Josh Taylor. So, yeah, man. Good, man. We're ready.
And that's some good sparring, though. Chris Eubank Jr. and Josh Taylor, mate. That is top quality sparring, mate.
Yeah. Of course, I mean, regardless of the weight difference with Chris Eubank Jr., I was still able to handle myself very well. As we all know, no one likes to spar him because he just literally takes people's head off. But for me, I handle myself very well, especially being a welterweight. And I just do what I have to do, get the rounds in, and get the experience as well.
So you're all in, you're all locked in fight mode for this Saturday. What's your predictions? Yeah. You know, you're going to make light work, you're going to go out there and just box and see what happens?
For me, it's the main, it was always to go out there and box and then see what happens. Go out there, work off my jab and build everything from the jab. And I always remember when I go into the ring, I become a robot. So whatever my coach says is what I do straight away. So I put it down as I give my life to my coaches at that time. So they're the second eyes that can see what I can't see in the ring.
Wow, I see the man is getting lyrical now. Okay. Mm-hmm. I see you. So, assuming Saturday goes all to plan, what are your plans for late 2017 going into next year?
Late 2017, looking to get an 8-round bout going on. I've been doing a lot of 8 rounds lately, feeling very comfortable and learning a trade and learning how to pace myself and when to work, especially sparring with Chris Eubank Jr. Seeing how I was doing a lot of rounds. So I was supposed to do a 6-rounder, but because it's so last minute, we're just going to have to go with a 4-rounder. So, you know, that means it's going to be a long warm up for me before I get in there, just to make sure I'm 100% warm. So, we're going to go for another 8-rounder, hopefully with someone with a better record. And then next year, move on to bigger and better things, man. Hoping to go for a title.
Next year is just about up in the levels, yeah?
100%.
By the way, are you joined by Cadet again with your ring walk? Maybe it was crazy last time.
I won't be joined by Cadet this time. It will be someone else, a special guest, an upcoming artist and a good friend of mine. We went to the same university, so yeah, make sure you look out, man, for the tune. It's going to be big.
It's going to be Too Slick. Now,
of course.
Chris, you want to shout out your social media before we get into the debate?
Of course, I'm on Instagram and I'm on Twitter at 2SlickChris, the number 2SlickChris. I'm on Snapchat as well. at BoxerChrisF2D and also Facebook at Chris Congo. So, you know, add me up, man. Follow the journey.
That's it. Holler at your boy.
Right. Yeah, yeah.
We're going to get it popping. Ladies and gents, for the fight fans locked in, for the football fans locked in, now it's time for some real talk on Pep Talk. Let's go.
Pep Talk.
Yes, you ready? Let's get into it. It's real talk, it's Pep Talk. So we're going to start with the boxing, and the major news last weekend was the confirmation that David Haye will yet again face Tony Bellew on December the 17th at London's O2 Arena. Now Pascal, our good friend Spencer Garon, he broke the news on the show last week. What a rematch this promises to be. It's the South London Haymaker against the Merseyside Bomber. Will it be repeat or revenge?
Well, you know, Frankie B, for David Haye, is going to be make or break, like Tony, like Kevin Hart's marriage. He has one more chance, you know.
Like Biggie said, one more chance.
Yeah, certainly one more chance, you know. I believe that should be his workout song, you know.
That's it.
I mean, look, let's face it, you know, David Haye is certainly coming to the, you know, to the late stages of his career. I'm wondering why even that fight is taking place, because, you know, his Achilles injuries was the reason why he lost the last fight. But, you know, at that age, and boxing is such a grueling sport, it could potentially happen again during the fight.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm quite concerned for David Haye in terms of his health, because, you know, he's still a very, very good boxer. What he's done for British boxing and for world boxing is, you know, it's been quite remarkable. So he would go down as a Hall of Famer in this country, certainly. So I question the reason why he wants to go back there. Perhaps he wants to revenge himself. Perhaps he wants to, you know, to prove to the world that he can beat Tony Bellew. That's for Tony Bellew. Look, you know, he's very smiling. He's very happy. You know, he certainly won the lottery last time, you know, by beating David Haye. Against all odds, you know, he managed to rise against, you know, the unlikely victory that everybody that I spoke to, I was at the fight, you know, and no one said that they had Tony Bellew to win. But he managed to prove that there are still miracles in boxing, and to me that was a very, very exciting match. So, I mean, the outcome for me, you know, based on the last fight, you know, Tony Bellew can only improve. And can David Haye do anything else? Can he do anything more at this stage? You know, and we know he has a new coach, you know, Ismael Salas, but yes. Is that
Linares' coach?
Is that going to be enough? You know, does David even speak Spanish? I mean, I'm not sure, but
Salas speaks English,
well, so that, I guess that's a bonus, but you know, it's about whether the desire for David Haye is still there. You know, talent, as far as talent, he's very talented. He has the talent to beat Tony Bellew, but it's going to become a mental fight first, I think, you know.
It's a question of really, will his body hold up for the whole 12 rounds, you know? Because Bellew's definitely going to push him. You saw that last time.
Yes,
you know, as Bellew says, make him miss and then make him pay.
Well, yeah, you know, I mean, Bellew did, you know, I mean, we cannot take any credit from David Bellew, because a lot of people say that, you know, the Achilles injuries was the reason why Bellew won. But, you know, Bellew made the fight very awkward, you know, for David Haye, and he took some of his best shots, you know. So we got to give the, you know, a lot of credit to Tony Bellew, who went up in weight from cruiserweight to heavyweight, when he'd never been there before. So he was really the one in uncharted territory, and he managed to overcome, you know, against all odds, you know. I remember it was something like 7-1 or, you know, 12-1. So, you know, some of the odds were very, very much in the favor of David Haye, being that champion at that division before, you know, and having held, you know, a world title. You know, everybody felt that David Haye would be the winner within 2-3 rounds. But when he went on and on and on until the 11th round, you know, it was certainly a very entertaining fight. So I you know, it could be a 50-50 fight, you know, based on the last performance. Tony Bellew edges it, but, you know, it could certainly go either way, honestly.
either way. So it's 50-50. Tony Bell, you calls himself the Fat Boy, so it could be a chance for a Bell you to repeat, you know, and it could be a chance for David Haye to get back into contention. Now, now, Chris Congo, we all saw a big upset in the first fight with Tony Bellew being victorious. What did we pick up from the first fight that will influence the second fight?
Right, I'm thinking for this fight, it's going to be a bit closer than the first one.
Sure.
I don't think I can call a win just yet. And with an Achilles injury like that for David Haye, it possibly could happen again because he's not getting any younger.
7 months. That's the thing. 7 months is really, you know, is pushing it, to be fair. Ruptured Achilles.
He's pushing it. So for me, I don't think I can call anything just as of yet. But I do think that Tony Bellew will bring the same awkwardness, and David Haye shouldn't go looking for the knockout like what he done before, and should take his time and pick his punches and set himself up.
Indeed.
Yeah.
Because last time, you know, what I had noticed is David Haye was thrown like almost the whole kitchen sink at Bellew, but Bellew was making the miss, and then David Haye was kind of gassing out. Because he came in heavy, you know. For me, David Haye's not at his best when he's heavy. He's at his best when he's light on his feet.
Yeah.
That's what he's about, you know. Then he drops the bombs on you, them haymakers. So like I said, seeing him at the presser, he looked trim, mate. He looked trim. He looked like he was going for some speed, mate. So
cheers.
This should be fireworks, mate.
Yeah. Okay, should be good.
Now, Bo, you know, from the first fight, in your opinion, was it just the injury that turned the fight against David Haye, or should we give Tony Bellew a little bit more credit?
I think it's both. It was the injury, but you also give Tony Bellew credit. The reality is this, and I know it eats at David Haye, is that he lost to a much smaller guy and a guy that he had a lot of disregard for.
Okay.
And it was. And I mean, this all stems from Bellew talking about what happened in sparring. And we have Mike, as a fighter, knows what happens in sparring stays in sparring. And Bellew talked, and that kind of made him upset. So he knows, like David Haye and David Haye minds, you know, you have to be sort of arrogant to be a fighter. And in David Haye minds, he knows I only lost because of an injury. But in Tony Bellew mind, he felt, hey, I could beat you anyway. So injury or no injury, I knew I could whoop. So it's a great clash there. But the first fight, though, honestly, man, I think you might see a more serious David Haye because he knows he kind of played around a little bit. He was taking his time because remember he said, like, listen, the fight will end when I want it to end. So he might take it a lot seriously. He might come out looking to end it early if he can. So that's what makes it interesting is you got one guy who only feels like, man, I only lost, dude, because I got hurt. And then you have because even with the one leg, it wasn't Bellew that stopped. Hey, it was the referee that finally decided that's it.
They threw the towel in, isn't it? Shane McGuigan.
So it wasn't Bellew that stopped the one-legged man. It was the fact that they were like, listen, we can't continue to watch this no more. Because it was obvious he was hurt. So, but you know what's funny is, Haye actually gained more respect in that loss from people than any victory he's ever had because he fought with one leg. So it's ironic how that happens in boxing.
Because the thing is, I know you're gonna get to when he fought Klitschko. And you know, complaining about the tone, and that everyone was like, you know what I mean? You know where I'm going with this. So I think he earned a lot of credibility this time round fighting on.
Right.
How was the first fight, Haye versus Bellew, received in America?
You know, it was received kind of mixed at first. A lot of people didn't understand the backdrop to this fight and why it happened. And the reason behind it. Then as it got closer towards the fight, because you know the one thing about here in America is you know we love drama. Drama is what gets us into anything. I don't know why we have to have drama.
You got Trump as your president, mate. You know,
and that's enough drama. Trump, you know what? Trump is like coffee. you drink too much of it and you have to go to the bathroom. But yeah, we love drama, and the back and forth between the two, and it was genuine dislike. Now, of course, they had respect later on, but it was genuine dislike. And I think a lot of people had more respect for Hay because of the way he lost, but a lot of people also respected Bellew only because when he went to hug Hay, he shoved Eddie Hearns off of him to go hug Hay, and everybody like, did you see that? He pushed the promoter out the way, and I don't know why that excited Americans so hard that he pushed the promoter out the way. I guess because we feel that, you know, when you have a lot of fighters who would just, you know, when the promoter jump in the ring, they just be all over them. So they appreciate that.
Well, I'm sure it's going to be very dramatic the second time round, and we all expect a closer fight this time. Now, moving on, last week, Pascal's man, Luis Ortiz, failed a drug test, putting his fight with Deontay Wilder in serious doubt for November the 4th. Now, Pascal, we were all looking forward to this fight, including Ortiz himself. He was so desperate to fight that he tried to put his high blood pressure under control, mate.
Well, you know, do you remember the Raekwon and Ghostface Killah album only built for Cuban Links?
That's it, yeah.
One of the classic Wu-Tang albums, certainly a solo albums. And I was very much rooting. I mean, you know, all the listeners of Pep Talk are quite familiar with my support of Luis Ortiz, but he's becoming, I mean, look, I even thought that perhaps there's a conspiracy where Al Haymon, perhaps, you know, is behind this, you know, the puppet master, because this fight excited everybody in boxing. You know, everybody was looking forward to Deontay Wilder fighting a bona fide undefeated champion. You know, I mean, his record is, you know, is as fantastic as it is. You know, a lot of people were pretty much on the fence with Deontay Wilder in terms of his achievement in the sport, you know, and the fact that he's been, you know, he's somehow been able to almost not fight the fighters that we wanted him to fight. He's, you know, Povetkin suffered the same fate, you know, and Andrei Jozric suffered the same fate, all at the ends of drugs. And now we have Luis Ortiz, also another fighter, you know, scheduled to fight Deontay Wilder, also victim of some form of drug abuse. Now, in terms of the fight itself, you know, Deontay Wilder has been very vocal about it, that he wants to carry on fighting. Of course, he would say that, but you know, the WBC has to take into consideration the safety of both fighters. So he looks like yet again, you know, Deontay Wilder will be, you know, missing the opportunity to prove himself against top opposition. I mean, to me, I think it's for Deontay Wilder, it's not the best, because, you know, he needs to prove to the rest of us that he's the champion that he deserves to be, you know, and it can only make him a better fighter, you know, as far as the beating the likes of, you know, the Bermain Stiverne and others, to me, doesn't give me enough confidence in his skill set. I'd like for him to be tested against some good, aggressive, technical fighters, and Ortiz was going to be that man for me, you know, but I'm also disappointed in Ortiz camp, because this was going to be the biggest fight, the biggest purse. But I'm sorry, Frankie, you know, as a business person, as his management, they should have made sure that Ortiz was completely clean of any form of drugs, you know, and that he was going to be focusing himself on the training and on becoming the best, best fighter that he could be on November 4th. Now that fight has been taken away from boxing fans, and also the opportunity for Ortiz to feed his family, to do so much with it. You know, it must be very disappointing and frustrating for people that supporting the, Luis Ortiz.
But you know what, Pascal, what I found was very funny was watching the IFL interview with Dillian White, and he said that the reason why he's taking high blood pressure tablets, Ortiz, is because he's like 60 years old. That's his real age.
Well, you know, we've said before that Ortiz reminds me of my uncle Kojo. You know, they do look alike, you know. And my uncle Kojo is 60 years old. So, you know, but look, it's... his boxing. Certainly, his boxing skills are very young. You know, he's been able to prove himself at a, you know, at a very good level. He's got good combinations, and he's undefeated, you know. And we want to see, you know, the best fighting the best. And, you know, Ortiz was ranked, you know, second in WBC rankings. So he certainly was the mandatory, you know. And it's a fight that, unfortunately, we'll never know what the outcome will be, you know. And Deontay Wilder, you know, fanboys are very happy that this fight is not happening. You know, the bomb squad, as they call themselves. But
the bomb squad.
But, you know, look, you know, good luck to Deontay Wilder, and whoever he fights on November 4th, I'm sure, will be another knockout win for him.
That's good. Right, Chris Congo, now, yes, Deontay Wilder, he gets a lot of stick for fighting bombs, but he has made attempts to fight creditable names such as Povetkin and Ortiz recently, but they failed drug tests. Should he be given more public sympathy?
A little bit, yes. I do think he should be, but the main thing is the fighters, I think they should get some sort of ban. They shouldn't be able to be fighting straight away, or it shouldn't be a straight ban. It should be a ban of 6 months. I watched Derek Chisora's interview, and he made a very good point. If you get caught for speeding or no insurance, they give you points, or they might take your license away for about, let's say, 6 months. And I think that's what should happen to these fighters, to make them reconsider and make sure they're not doing something like that again. So I really think the fighters should get a ban 100%.
But he did say, well, the report was that, you know, he was trying to keep his high blood pressure under control. Should that be given some mitigating circumstances in this instance?
If he was trying to keep his blood pressure low, he should have said from the early stages, at least. He should have given a heads up.
It's the second drug test he's failed, I believe.
The second?
Crazy.
Yeah, now it should be like a year back. We're looking at.
Now, Bo, moving on to Deontay Wilder again. He recently came out and said that, you know, he's gone past the Mike Tyson, the most feared fighter, like Tyson now, more than Tyson now, as you said, something along those lines. How was that received in the US? And are you convinced by that statement?
Wow. It's ironic you asked me that, because I did a debate earlier with a guy about it.
It's crazy.
It's not received very well by a lot of people. But what people have to look at and understand is that, look at the angle for which he's coming from with this, which is three separate occasions. I tried to fight people that you guys wanted me to fight,
positive.
Right. So he's just saying, if somebody tells you, you know, I'm trying to think of a name of a guy you don't like, but think of a guy you don't like, and somebody tells you, yo man, he has something to say about you, and then you confront him and he's quiet, okay? Then they tell you another dude you don't like has something to say about him. You know, so after the third person, you can be like, okay, everybody must be scared, because I confronted each one of you guys and you guys ain't talking, so you must be scared. So I understand where he's coming from. Now, is it true? Hell no. It's not true. Alright? And it's really not true, because if you look at the guys in Spilka, if you look at the guys in Jared Washington, you're able to outbox Deontay Wilder. Why? Because Deontay believes in his right hand so much, he forget about all his other skills. I tell everybody, if you want to see the best Deontay Wilder, go back and watch him when he fought Chris Areola, when his right hand was broken, he couldn't use it. That's when you saw the best of him. He was using that jab. He was using that hook. He was moving his feet because he didn't have his right hand. So he had to use the other skill. So, in essence, I think there are some people, though, that they're cautious about the right hand to not get hit by it, because it is probably the best sleeper. Him and Adonis Stevens have probably the best sleeper in all of boxing, right? But I can't say people are afraid of him only because you know that, hey, if you're good, and that's what made the Ortiz fight so intriguing, was this was a guy that was good enough that could have offset your right hand. Like, very skillful fighters like Floyd Mayweather. You can have power with Floyd. It didn't matter. Guys always can outpunch Floyd, punch harder than Floyd. It didn't matter because he had the skill to offset it. Andre Ward and Kovalev, you know, they have the skill to offset that. And that's what it was with Luis Ortiz. And, I just want to add one thing. The sad thing about this is, whether you want to tell me, I think what people have to understand is, even if you want to tell me I have blood pressure pills, I have an issue with that is you're an elite level athlete with high blood pressure.
Yep.
So the New Jersey just paid a $22 million lawsuit out from the guy that Mike Perez fought and injured real bad. They just paid a $22 million lawsuit. So even if you want to tell me it's high blood pressure pill, it becomes a situation of health. So New Jersey would have wanted to know, are you healthy enough to fight? Right? And it's messed up because even if the fight is, but it's funny how Deontay Wilder wants to go on with the fight with Ortiz, but they want to get it with Beckett. Because I was trolling. I took a picture. I don't know if you guys ever saw the movie called Skull Island.
No. I think I've heard of it. Okay,
there's a movie called Skull Island. What it is you go to this island, King Kong is there. And I took a picture of King Kong, and I took a picture of a windmill. And I said, you guys really think this right here in King Kong is scared of this broken down ass windmill? And that was just a good windmill. I was trolling all the fans, you know, talking about, well, come on, man. Ain't no Kong scared of no windmill, you know? I called him the Alabama skinny leg bum squad fighter. I was clowning him. And every chance it comes up, I eat crow. So I'm eating crow again on another station. I wish I'd have called in last week and skipped this week now.
In America, though, sorry to interrupt. In America, he's not really respected as, you know, WBC heavyweight champion. Is that right?
No, I think he's not really respected. I think people recognize him as a title holder more than they do a WBC champion. And it's not his fault. It really is. I think if Deontay Wilder showed you some skill, like when he fought Stavern and you saw the skill set continue to go, I think people would feel more confident. I think a lot of people just don't like Wilder because he gets outboxed and he gets bailed out by the right hand. And Americans, we have a long history of, with heavyweights, about them being dominant. You know, like Tyson had power, but Tyson had skill also.
Deontay
Wilder is the only champ. You know, you're finding a lineage of Mike Tyson, Larry Holmes, Muhammad Ali, George Foreman. You know, that lineage you're following, holding the title. So, you know, and I think that's the reason why he's not really taking in respect. And then you look at guys like Anthony Joshua, Vladimir Klitschko. I mean, either one of those dudes that night they fought, a lot of people feel like they'd have demolished Deontay Wilder.
I certainly think, my personal opinion is, if he fights Joshua, I think, you know, I think Joshua is more likely to beat him. But again, you know, that right hand is the equalizer, you know, from Deontay Wilder. So, you know, in heavyweight boxing, just takes one punch, you know, and anyone can go down. That's the beauty of the heavyweights, that's for sure.
Agree.
Now, moving down the weight classes, the WBC has ordered Canelo Triple G 2 for next year, March or May. Now, Chris Congo, what will Canelo need to do next time out to convince all three judges that it should indeed be 118-110?
For me, I think Canelo, he should box similar to how Danny Jacobs boxed Golovkin. Danny Jacobs took his time, he worked off his jab. He got hit with a few shots, but I feel like Canelo has a better defense than Jacobs. And I feel like he should work at a certain rate for him to match Golovkin this time. For it not to be...
Yeah, it's just a work rate, isn't it? Yeah.
And obviously the main thing for this fight, I think he should take his time. Take his time instead of rushing. And I think, I don't know if he was trying to blow Golovkin out, but
how must it feel as a fighter? You hit you know, the opposing boxer with your best shots, and yet he just keeps marching forward. How would that feel?
For me, I think he should have, once that happened, I think he should have known that it's not gonna be a knockout, and he's just gonna have to go to distance and to keep for Canelo to keep working. But I also feel that Golovkin should have went down to the body a lot to slow him down even more and make him stay there.
Pascal,
wait.
You know, I picked Triple G the first time out, right? You know, obviously, you know, Adelaide Bird, she interrupted. But second time out next year, whether it's March or Cinco de Mayo in May, I'm actually going for Canelo this time as favourite. Oh. I just think Triple G will be a year older. I believe Canelo would have worked out what he needs to do. Just needs to be a bit more busier. And maybe he could steal, you know, a 12-round victory. But what do you think in terms of favourite for next year's rematch?
I believe that, you know, you are probably correct. You know, I think that Canelo still being the younger fighter, and he didn't take much punishment in that fight. You know, he certainly will have the advantage. And he will have learned a lot from that fight also.
Yes.
And, you know, in terms of, you know, being able to stay there all 12 rounds.
It'll take no risk next time.
I agree. None of the fighters were able, none of the fighters took a stand in the count, or none of them were knocked down. You know, what I was disappointed about in Canelo is his lack of work to the body, because we all know that Gennady Golovkin is vulnerable to the body. You know, Daniel Jacob exposed that, and there were moments in the fight when Canelo did that very well. You know, he did, you know, exploit the vulnerabilities. But at the very same time, Gennady Golovkin is a very determined fighter, and I've never seen anybody cut the ring so well in a very long time in the sport. And he was advancing furiously forward, but he himself wasn't able to, you know, to trouble Canelo too much. So, you know, it will be a fantastic fight, you know, Frankie B, that's for sure. And, you know, there has to be a decider. And Canelo certainly, you know, could edge it. But he will have to do a lot more work, because, you know, in terms of output, you know, the output certainly went to Triple G. Mm-hmm. The cleaner work, the more eye-catching shots, certainly went Canelo's way. So what Canelo will have to do is Canelo will have to make sure that, you know, during the last 10 seconds of each round, he just needs to show the judges that he's the more busier of the two opponents, just to kind of sway the decisions to go his way, you know. But in terms of talent, in terms of, you know, tactical ability, technical ability, I believe that Canelo can edge him the second time around.
So you're going ginger second time round.
I'm a Canelo fan, you know. I think I'm talking more with my heart than I'm talking with my head, but I think that Canelo can win it decisively the second time.
But, you know, fair play to Triple G as well. You know, we've become more convinced by him, because when we first started Pep Talk, remember Troops? We used to call Triple G Triple P. We won't say what the P stands for.
Yeah, but, yes, I remember that. But,
you know.
But at the same time, you know, Frankie B, I'm a bit disappointed, because I wanted Jamal Charlo to fight Triple G.
Yes.
You know, he deserves that opportunity.
But and, even against Canelo, that would be a sick fight.
That certainly
Charlo
would be,
Canelo, gosh.
Yeah, that certainly would be a good fight. But, you know, these fighters work very hard to put themselves in a position to, you know, to earn a title shot, a mandatory shot. And because of the WBC, you know, political power, you know, they are asking and they are making the fight again, which is quite unusual, you know, because it's not like it was a split decision draw. So why would the WBC force a rematch? I just don't quite understand that, you know. I'm a bit confused, you know. It's the result is there. Canelo's not particularly as interested. He possibly wants to move on to other fighters, and I think that Charlo should be given that chance, you know. And Charlo certainly will be fancying his chances against Gennady Golovkin, because he's got the power and he's got the skill set, and he'll be good to see, you know, that fight happening. So, you know, if I'm brutally honest, I wouldn't want to see that fight again unless Charlo can fight Gennady Golovkin. And if Charlo doesn't succeed, then let, you know, make a year-end fight with Canelo towards the end of the year next year, you know, as a more exciting fight.
Or maybe if Canelo fights Billy Joe, right? If he manages to get past Billy Joe, right? Then he comes back for Triple G. And that's a proper unification.
Yes, of course, yeah. I mean, that will be certainly very entertaining, you know. But I think that, you know, the WBC intervening in this, you know, decision to ask for a rematch, to command a rematch, is not what they should be doing. I think, you know, over the last few months, you know, we've seen the fans almost engineer fights by social media, by people, you know, like, you know, the Pep Talk, you know, a podcast, of course, and people talking about boxing, you know, we've influenced promoters to start putting fighters together into great matches. And it is up to the public to decide whether they want to see it again, you know, not up to the political, you know, decisions of the WBC. You know, that's my take on it.
Bo, do you know any good judges for the rematch?
Yeah, me, you,
Chris Congo,
and Mike Brown, Chris Congo, and over there, you know, anybody over there at Pep Talk, man, we all could have. Yeah, I mean, Stevie Wonder could have came in and gave a better scorecard. But
you know, Ray Charles.
Yeah, you know what's funny is, though, 118-110 seems to be the new thing for everybody now.
I almost wonder if
the judges are purposely scoring that so they don't make the one judge bad. Like, they're you know, they're like, oh, we don't want to make our judge look bad, so everybody do a score 118-110.
And even a Camel Linares split decision. Seriously, did I miss something with that fight? Because Linares was in control.
Yes, I agree with you. I agree. Linares was in control. But, you know, the interesting thing about that fight was, if you take out the 118-110, I think people are focusing on the 118-110, so they automatically think conspiracy because of one scorecard. And I generally tell people, well, if you take out the one scorecard, you had one judge had 114-114, then another judge had 115-113. They only had a difference of one round. So if either judge would have scored it one round differently, we could have had a winner, which tells me that this fight was close. It was a close fight.
Yeah, it was a very close fight.
Yeah, so, you know, the interesting thing is, see, the WBC is starting to act like a girlfriend that won't go away because they know Canelo don't want that belt. They know Canelo don't want that belt. He's there publicly. Hey, if I win, I'm dropping that piece of garbage. I don't want that belt. And he said this, and they're just like, oh, we're gonna, you know, it's you know, they're acting like, hey. And I guess they're doing it to save face because if they reorder the fight and Canelo is like, I'm about fighting him, then they can say, okay, well, we don't have to put our belt up when you do fight him. It's crazy how they're acting, man. I mean, seriously, you know, it's crazy. But at the same time, I think Canelo should get over whatever his issues is with the WBC. Mm-hmm. Because at the end of the day, the WBC has to do what's good for their organization. So even if you don't like what they did, which I don't see what the problem is, they agreed. You knew you had to face Golovkin, the winner, when you and Cotto fought. You knew after Mirkhan you had to face Golovkin. So it wasn't like they dropped this on you by surprise. But he's going to have to get over that. If you're telling me you want to go for legacy, which has become undisputed, then you're going to have to get over that. And you really need to get it. But, I don't know about this fight, though. I'm kind of on the fence. I kind of agree with both the guys who said earlier. I think it was, Pasquale who said that Canelo, it does have that feel that they don't want to take this fight right away, and I do kind of agree with Pasquale that it does have that feel to it to me, because I don't see that aggressiveness from Austin them. Like, Austin them aren't normally they aren't normally people who like to remake fight. Remember when Canelo barely beat Adesanya Lara, they was like, okay, get to the back of the line. They aren't normally people who are in a rush to just jump right back in there. I mean, look at Oscar's career. You know, he rematched who? Only Shane Mosley? So, you know, he fought Chavez twice, but he fought him once, and they waited a long time and fought him again. So, Yeah, I agree with Pascal, and I definitely agree with Congo, is that Canelo would have to do what Daniel Jacobs did, but the problem is he don't have that athleticism that Daniel Jacobs had.
Indeed. Well, you know, hopefully the fight gets made, and either way, you know, we'll all be tuning in, locking in, that's for sure. Now, Chris Congo, you know, you spoke about sparring Chris Eubank Jr. In camp. He's in action this weekend in Stuttgart against Avni Yildirim,
yeah,
a Turkish fighter. How has Eubank Jr. looked in camp, and you know, what do you expect the outcome to be this weekend?
In camp, and obviously sparring him, he's been very sharp. Everybody knows him for his work rate. His work rate has been a constant thing for him, you know. And you know,
output. Yeah.
Eubank, he likes fighters that don't really move around and that are there static, and he's able to throw his flows. That's why I was brought in for sparring, because a lot of the time when I was moving, he didn't like it. He got a bit frustrated, but at the same time, it was good for him, because if he ain't able to hit me and there's someone there that's static there and able to just not move, I mean, he'll have a field day. So for me, I haven't really watched much of Yildirim, but I've heard that he's sort of like a Arthur Abraham, staying there with hands up and just plots forward. So I think you should see him literally go all out for 12 rounds, and believe me, he can go all out for 12 rounds. His pace is very high.
Some people, some critics do say Eubank Jr. at the weight, the power doesn't quite transfer, you know, that weight class. And you know, obviously you sparred with him. What happens in sparring stays in sparring, but in terms of the power, will that be enough for him to go on to win the World Boxing Super Series?
It will be very difficult.
Callum Smith can bang.
Callum Smith can hit. I've heard as well that
Gross
this got, new bank that at super middleweight is basically his natural weight. And he doesn't really have many struggles of getting down. So I do believe he is the weaker out of everyone in the Super 6. But I feel like because his work rate is very high and his punch output is very high, he should be able to do some big things in there. But in terms of the winner, I believe someone else is going to win, but hopefully he does the job.
And like they say, skills pay the council tax, as Tunde Ajayi says, you know.
Of course.
Cracking. Now, good luck, Chris, this weekend. We're behind you, and I'm sure the whole of the Miguel's massive as well is behind you. Big up, Miguel's. Yeah. Big up, Team Congo.
All the best, Congo.
Now it's interview time. And this week, our boxing correspondent, Shaz, the boxing nut, made his way to see a young fighter signed to Goodwin Promotions that will fight under Joe Joyce and Ian Lewinson, haymaker, ring star, undercard on October the 20th. It's the super welterweight, Tom Ansell.
Pep Talk UK are joined by a young man who's looking to make his mark within the profession. It's Mr. Tom Ansell. How are you doing?
Yeah, good, mate. How are you?
I'm very well. Now, Tom, first and foremost, up until about 5 minutes ago, I liked you until you disclosed that you're a hammer.
Yeah.
What's wrong, lad? Too many punches to the head?
Nah. Just I've gone and seen him quite a bit recently. Saw us lost against Tottenham the other day. But yeah, man, it's going well for West Ham at the moment with transfers, but not really for the results. But yeah, see what happens.
Now, you're a Chelmsford-based lad.
Yeah.
Got Essex behind you. In terms of your background, no amateur fights, Where did the boxing come from?
I was playing rugby for a little while, and I wanted to get fit for pre-season. Pretty much, I was quite chubby, so I went down to the local boxing club, and they put me in for an unlicensed fight. Then I ended up winning that, and then just got the bug pretty much straight away. And then I had a couple of trials for Francis Warren for a TV show called Total Combat. I got on that, I dropped a guy twice and then won my first fight on there, but I had to pull out for injury after that, and then just thought I might as well go for it, I'm going to go for pro. So I ended up going pro. I was supposed to sign with Mickey Elliott, but I ended up breaking my hand, and then Mickey didn't want me anymore, so I signed for Goodwin. So yeah.
Now you've already had a fight.
Yep.
As a middleweight for Goodwin.
Yep.
How did you get on with that fight?
Yeah, I won that. I dropped a very tough opponent called Liam. Liam.
We'll call him Liam.
And dropped him in the first round, and then I needed to get rounds in. I had a year out with my broken hand. But yeah, it felt good to be at your call, the home of British boxing. So yeah, then next fight, big one at the O2 Indigo.
Your Honour, I've seen you around the press conference, I've seen you around the media days. You're fighting on the Joe Joyce, Lewis and undercard. It's a haymaker promotion, but you're going in as a Goodwin fighter.
Yep.
How are you feeling about that?
Yeah, I'm feeling good. I'm not really worried about the big stage at all, really. I just want to get my fight over and done with. I need to get my record up. I need to get these fights. These fights are just a great platform for young prospects like me, really. And yeah, I can't wait to be part of such a huge show.
Well, we're going to be there on December the... No, on October the 20th, I'm going to be there. Sorry, I've got hay belly on my brain. Yeah. I'm going to be there on October the 20th. Looking forward to a cracking day of boxing. Now, with you, what are your social media handles for listeners that want to give you a follow?
So I've got Tom Ansell 9 on Instagram, Tom Ansell on Facebook, and Tom Ansell 9 again on Twitter.
And do you want to give any of your sponsors a shout out?
Yeah, I'll give all of them a shout out. I've got Nick Ansell PTs, my brother's PT company. I've got BTG Management. I've got Complete Physio and Fitness, Red Lift Hire, BT Electricals, and that's it at the moment. So,
cool.
Yeah.
Well,
I've got one more. I've got Top Guard UK and JFB as well.
That's not one, that's two, but we'll let you have that. What we're looking to do, Tom, is I'm hoping this is the first of many an interview.
Yeah.
And I'm hoping that I'll catch up with you soon, but I'll definitely be around fight week and I'll see you fight night.
Brilliant. Thank you very much.
Take care, my buddy. Thank you.
We wish Tom Ansell the best of luck on fight night. Cracking interview, Shaz. Now it's football time. So let's review the important results last week in the Premier League. Now let's welcome MJ in the building. MJ the Red, how you doing, bro?
Thank you, D. Not too bad. MJ back in the building. A bit lonely, a little bit disgusted. Because that...
Draw at Newcastle, yeah?
Brendan Klopp is destroying my club, okay? You know, Brendan Rodgers is clearly infected Jurgen Klopp. And we can't win a game. It's one win in the last seven. It's pretty sad because I've been sat in all weekend, locked all the shutters away because everyone is making fun. What is going on? Brendan Klopp needs to be sorted out, but look forward to discussing this as well as everything else with all the panellists.
Yes, indeed. Right, now we turn our attention to the biggest game of last weekend, and that was Manchester City beating Chelsea 1-0 at the Bridge. Now, Pascal, City were in scintillating form, and they put Chelsea to the sword at their home ground at the Bridge, mate.
Kevin De Bruyne, the goal was absolutely
Prince Harry,
super.
Prince Harry, man, he done it
Prince
again. Prince Harry
in disguise. Yes, of course. Shout out to Prince Harry. Listen to Pep Talk, mon ami. Listen, he needed something special to separate those two teams because, you know, we are certainly talking about the champions, current champions, against, aspiring champions, and, you know, Pep Guardiola this season has you know, has proven to, or has had to up the ante, you know. He's had to show that, you know, he's the manager that we all expected him to be. And it seems to me that they are finding, Manchester City are finding a momentum that he's carrying on every game. You know, okay, yes, perhaps they didn't score more than one goal, but, you know, he was against a quality side. You know, Conte's side very well organized. You know, the midfield of Bakayoko and Kante is a tremendous midfield with tremendous, you know, work rate.
A lot of grit there.
You know, yeah. Lot of athleticism and a lot of guide, you know. So that, to me, which embodies the, you know, the English game. But somehow, you know, the Spanish maestro, the matador that is Pep Guardiola, managed to find a create opportunity, you know, in unleashing the creativity of Kevin De Bruyne on the field. And, you know, it was a fantastic finish, fantastic, you know, piece of ingenuity that earned them, you know, three valuable points. Because, you know, these are the games that mm-hmm. are the make or break games. We know that Manchester City would beat any half decent team. So for them beating Chelsea, you know, away from home, you know, let's make this certainly for the Manchester United fans who are beginning to grow a big head. You know, out of the two Manchester sides, Manchester City, in my opinion, Manchester City have got the advantage because they are beating, you know, a top four side, you know, so they should certainly be considered as the leaders in the league. Though they are sharing points, I would edge Manchester City simply on the victory that they had against Chelsea. So let's see how the heads will perform against the other, you know, notable sides in the Premier League. I think the Liverpool game is coming up very soon, so I expect an interesting game. And I would like Liverpool to make it as difficult as possible, you know, just so that we can see how good the Jose Mourinho side is this season. But apart from that, you know, credit to Manchester City, you know, even with the absence of Aguero, they still managed to, you know, to win and to earn a much needed 3 points.
Yes. Now, MJ, Man City are looking, they're looking good, mate, you know. But in saying that, you know, we said the same thing last season and they started petering away and falling to pieces. Now also Aguero is out for a while. Bernard Mendy's out until next year, April. Do you think that's going to derail their charge to the Premier League title?
Guys, credit where credit's due. But I'm going to give zero credit to Pep Guardiola because let's be real here. Any one of us could manage that squad.
Spending that amount of money. Yeah, yeah.
And God knows how much. And he showed his true colours. He couldn't even get over Arsenal. When Arsenal were going through a terrible period, Guardiola couldn't beat them in the semi-final. The so-called greatest coach of our generation, which Zinedine Zidane has eclipsed. And he's come to the Premier League. Uh-huh. And we've seen how ordinary he is. He is another Mourinho, another checkbook manager. Mm-hmm. And he's been in there the first season. How much money did they spend? He couldn't get competitive.
They spent half a billion, haven't they? Man City since
then. Honest, guys. I mean, any one of us can manage that side. It pretty much manages itself. Yet Guardiola pretends as if Leroy Sané is this player who is...
It's a wonder kid that's just spotted from a youth team.
They spent 14 million on Leroy Sané. I'm tired of people saying Guardiola. I mean, what we saw on Saturday was basically a side that invested a lot last season, didn't really sell any useful players. They got rid of all the kind of crud, and they actually went again and invested 200 and something million, which is ridiculous, versus Chelsea, who they've lost Costa, but they've actually, don't get me wrong, Chelsea always spend, but last season Conte showed, and this season as well, because yet again he didn't get his first choice targets, he's showing us how to manage a side. They got rid of Matic, for less money they brought by Bakayoko. I mean, mm-hmm. we can see things like this. It's not ridiculous like spending 49 million on a right back than spending 51 point something million on a left back. It's absolutely ridiculous. So, yes, Man City are currently leading at the minute. Are they going to buy the title? I honestly hope not. Because if we're putting it down to who spends the most, we might as well just give up right now and just leave them. Because, you know, next season as well, Guardiola... And plus, let's be real, Guardiola wasn't done. He still wanted to add Alexis Sanchez. He's just going to go out there, mm-hmm. buy all the players, And then at the end, he's going to raise his hand up. I'm a great coach. My name is Pep Guardiola. I mean, I haven't won shit since, well, I haven't won anything of note since I've left Lionel Messi. Because the Bundesliga, fair enough, he won it in a time in which they signed all of Dortmund's players.
Lewandowski.
They signed Lewandowski. Mario Götze looked good. They signed Götze. And he won, what, two Bundesligas? When he came to the Premier League, I think we're seeing the real Pep Guardiola. But in terms of Aguero's trips to the late night district, the red light
in Amsterdam, yeah. What's he doing in Dam?
There's some of the nice coffee bars over there. God knows what he was doing there. Apparently, he was there with one of his South American buddies who was actually there at a concert.
Yeah, but and coincidentally, his missus has dumped him. So you worked that out.
Wow, bloody hell.
That was in the papers.
plus, obviously, that's not his first missus, because he was with Maradona's... he was married to Maradona's daughter. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And then shortly after that, you know, I mean, we don't really know what's going on, so we can't really speculate. But whatever he was up to, it's, you know, it's definitely cost him quite a lot. yeah, that's what I will say. But back to the football, yes, they did win. But hopefully City have more tougher tests ahead of them.
Go on. Yes, and it's still early days. Now, moving on to your team, MJ. Liverpool, Coutinho, fantastic strike, mate. He's come back and he's hit the ground running. But Newcastle got back in it and the game ended a draw, mate. A bit of perspective on Liverpool's performance?
Yeah, I mean, really, it's looking pretty, pretty bad. I mean, anyone who saw that goal being conceded. I mean, if you watch under 12s...
Very ugly goal, yep.
Yeah, if you watch under 12s football and you see the sort of goal that Hossam scored against Liverpool, literally a ball going in between two centre-backs. I mean, both teams should be ashamed of themselves. And it just goes to it. At the moment, Liverpool, we're not even looking that great going forward. And we just seems to huff and puff a lot. We play nice, pretty stuff. Basically, I'm going to put it as Arsenal of old, when Arsenal went Manchester. But Arsenal were playing pretty football, no one really shooting. But in Liverpool's case, we're shooting, we just don't have a striker. Daniel Sturridge is done. Roberto Firmino.
He's done, yeah? Okay.
Roberto Firmino, he started off as a centre half up until when he was 19. Then they saw he had some skill, they moved him into central midfield, attacking midfield, if you will, a wide player. Somehow Jurgen Klopp has said, you know what, you're my number nine. Don't get me wrong, I like Firmino. You can see he's a quality footballer. Yeah,
he scored some bangers as well, we can't forget that.
But he can't finish those tap-ins, you know. We need someone who's going to score tap-ins. We've got Salah, we've got Mane to give you those bangers and all that kind of stuff. We need someone who can finish. And unfortunately, at the club, we don't have a finisher. And this is the reason why Liverpool, even though we tend to create a lot of chances in games, we can't put teams away. Which is the reason why a lot of Liverpool fans are actually getting a little bit upset. Especially with Rafa Benitez. I mean, pretty much, it was kind of like, you know when you see your old girlfriend, we put the ring on Jurgen Klopp. And then we run into an old girlfriend, who, really, we don't want her to be looking good. We want her to be looking a little bit chubby or you know, something not quite right there. But Benitez definitely showed Liverpool fans what they've been missing. Because offensively, we weren't great. But defensively, we were always solid on the Rafa. Plus, he took us, won the Champions League in his first season.
Because you had that.
The final in 2007. Yeah. So when you see someone, that sort of manager, go up against Klopp, we definitely have a lot of work to be done. And the next game's a big one. The one which every Liverpool fan looks in their calendar at the start of the season. United, we don't like them one bit. And yeah, that's definitely going to be big. But yeah, I mean, I'm not sure you boys saw the Newcastle game, but from a Liverpool point of view, utterly disappointing.
Yeah, it's the same old story. You guys just can't defend, you know. We can relate to that as Arsenal fans. But what's bemusing is the fact that, you know, the teams that win the Premier League, a lot of them are the teams with the best defence, mate. You know, they score a lot of goals, but they also shut them out too. And that kind of perplexes me, why you guys didn't get that defender, you know, even though you were trailing Van Dijk for the whole summer.
Saka could have been that guy. So, I mean, at the moment it's quite bad because we can't score. Because I know everyone thinks, oh, Liverpool, they're going to outscore. But at the moment, we actually cannot score. We score one goal, that's it.
I mean, we keep on creating chances, don't get me wrong, but we just cannot score.
It's tippy-tappy, isn't it? Tippy-tappy.
We can't. It's what's it called? It's pretty disappointing, but what can you do?
Pascal, you did say that, you know, Rafa would surprise his old team.
I certainly did, you know. I mean, a lot of it was wishful thinking, but, you know, MJ made something.
Do you have some African voodoo person? Is that what you got? Shame on you.
I mean, look, you know, what the one thing that we know for sure is that, you know, Rafa Benitez, as, you know, he's a talented manager, you know, he's won European titles with Liverpool. Mm-hmm. But also with Chelsea.
He won La Liga with Valencia.
With Valencia. He's not the most consistent, but certainly when it comes to tactical analysis, he's a man that studies the game very well, and he knows how Liverpool plays because he was once a coach of Liverpool. He knew exactly what Jurgen Klopp was going to do, and he contained Liverpool very well, despite, you know, going down 1-0. I expected Newcastle to galvanize themselves and to certainly, you know, try as often as possible to make the game very frustrating for Liverpool, and they certainly did that, you know. And I was listening to the press conference where Jurgen Klopp was claiming that one of his players was fouled in the penalty box and that that warranted a penalty, but at the same time he also said that in games like this you need to create chances, you need to enable to get the points. So sometimes you cannot wait for the referee's decision to win the game. Liverpool didn't create enough chances, in my opinion, to warrant the game and to warrant winning the game. I felt that Newcastle, you know, did very well and did enough to earn a very good point, and it's a very important point because for Liverpool, this is a game they should win, you know, to remain as a top 14. But I'm just concerned as to whether that top 4 spot will be remaining with them. There's a lot of teams competing for that spot, including Arsenal. But if Liverpool do not address the defensive duties, you know, they may well see themselves back in that much familiar UEFA Cup place, which is the fifth place onwards. So, you know, there's certainly some players that Klopp should be looking at in January transfer, you know, even if it's a loan deal, or even bring Sacco back. You know, I'm not sure whether that's still on the cards, but they need to strengthen themselves defensively.
They should. They need that, you know. But you know, as an Arsenal fan, we can't really talk. But you know, we're now ticking along. Unbeaten in 8 games, mate. So happy days. Now, Arsenal, Pascal. 2-0 victory over Brighton. Now, look, for me, we should be beating Brighton by more than 2-0, mate, at home. I know we had, like, I think 2 shots off the line cleared. Lacazette hit the post. But still, you know, we need to put down a statement, and we should have put Brighton to the sword.
Well, you know, it was even the 2-0 victory was a flattering victory for us, because if you saw the way we started, very, very slow. You know, it was a bit like a car that you start in the winter, you know, when you have to put the foot on the accelerator to try and get the fire going. It was very, very, very boring to watch, you know. And concerningly, you know, Frankie B, I'm not sure if you saw the stadium, but it was very empty. Mm-hmm. You know, people are not, Arsenal are not capturing the imagination of their fans.
Yeah, yeah. Arsenal have lost the spark. There's no spark in that team anymore.
There's no imagination, you know, there's nothing that makes you want to sit down and watch the game, you know. It's not like before. So there's certainly, as you say, a bit of spark has gone. But the game came alive when Lacazette stroked this superb strike. You know, he reminds me, you know, he could become our very, you know, they call him the new Ian Wright, He reminds me of a Jermaine Defoe type player, you know, when Jermaine Defoe was at his height of his powers at West Ham and, you know, dare I say Tottenham. He's that kind of player, you know, that can score and that can bring the magic at any given time. So I expect Lacazette to be far more prolific. He was unlucky. That would have been one of the goals of the week, perhaps even goal of the month. You know, he was a very good strike. But, you know, Nacho Monreal did well by reacting well, by scoring the first goal. And the piece of skill from Sanchez allowed...
Oh, yeah, the back heel.
You know, that was very
That was good. Naughty. That was naughty. Definitely.
Oh, I didn't see that coming, you know, but that's what a special player like Sanchez can do. And Alexi Iwobi took that very well, you know, in his favorite sort of, you know, tapping side, you know, side foot. You know, the only way that Iwobi can strike the ball, he managed to put it in, he managed to score. So, I mean, look, it's 3 points, you know, but one thing that we've realized is we've kept a clean sheet. Ozil will drop. Ramsey is able to move
right
well.
So.
You know, so, is Wenger finally finding the balance that Arsenal needs, you know? And is it a case where, you know, for QB, do we just play ugly and then grind out results and keep a clean sheet? Or do we try to play super slick by bringing in all these players, all these marquee players, and, mm-hmm. you know, leave ourselves, you know, in defensive trouble?
Yeah.
So, you know, it's a difficult one, but, you know, so far, you know, let's give credit where it's due. Numbers don't lie, you know. We kept a clean sheet again. Although we was very close to concede, you know, we kept a clean sheet. So, you know, the Arsenal keep marching on. That's all we can say.
Happy days, mate. We're going to win the league. We're Arsenal.
I'm not sure about that.
Now, MJ, are you convinced by this sudden resurgence of the Gooners?
You know what I've got to say? Credit where credit's due. This time, I'm actually going to give credit. Arsenal have actually been, I mean, considering the start of the season, it's definitely improved a hell of a lot. And you might say 2-0, but you kept a clean sheet and you won a game against a lesser side. Because let's be real, Arsenal have always done well against the lesser sides. Arsenal have actually arrived. We need to see what they do in the big games.
Flat-track bullies, that's what they call Arsenal. Yeah.
Yeah, which they do really well. I mean, they did really well against Chelsea, but it seems as if you guys have a hoodoo over Chelsea. Because a lot of people in competitive football, you absolutely put them to the sword.
I'm loving that, mate.
So we want to see more from Arsenal in these big games, because that's what it's all about. And also, this week being International Week, we've seen some pretty strange stories coming out. Well, kind of, one from an ex-Arsenal player. The rumours of Emmanuel Eboué, whether or not he's had a health scare or not. Which
HIV,
is,
yeah.
Yeah, which invasion has come out and said, no, it's not the case. So I'm sure ourselves and all the listeners actually wish him a speedy recovery, whatever's going on there.
And what about Fabregas admitting that he threw the pizza at Fergie?
I know. You just know it's International Week when all this kind of stuff was being buried. And then the other one making the rounds is the fact that Arsene Wenger is ready to get rid of Mesut Ozil, because
rightly so.
He's looking like he's ready to swap him in January, because Ozil was gone under the radar, hasn't quite signed, but had been very, very sly the way in which he's actually behaved.
And he's having a go at the legends as well, the cheek of it.
Today, the papers are picking up that perhaps Jose Mourinho, who does like Ozil, I mean, even though there's things that Ozil wrote in his autobiography about how Mourinho called him a pussy one time, pulled him up at half time, cannot tackle. And Ozil said he was crying in showers. He goes, we were 2-0 up. I don't understand why Jose was picking on him. But Mourinho himself has said that in training, when he had Ozil there, that when all the players, he said, if he looks away from the way Ozil touches the ball, he would know Ozil had the ball. Apparently, that's how skillful he is. Well, no, that's true. I don't know why Mourinho would lie about that. But Mourinho does seem to have some affection for Ozil, despite the fact he thinks Ozil needs to man up and actually be more direct. So the rumours are, will Ozil do a Van Persie and end up in Old Trafford with a big contract next year? Which, obviously, is not. Mm-hmm. But it certainly seems as if Arsenal have realised that they don't want to lose both Ozil and Sanchez on a free. And the way the season started, with both Manchester clubs getting up there, they're trying to be bullies and want to bully every club in the league.
Mm-hmm.
And if Sanchez goes to City next season and Ozil goes to
Man United, yeah.
That's not going to be a good thing for the Premier League or Arsenal as a whole. But in general, Arsenal doing quite well. I think if we sell you back Oxlade-Chamberlain, perhaps...
No returns, mate. No returns in the receipt.
Liverpool, so we swap destinies. We can't win a game. We haven't won a game in 7. Apart from, I think since Leicester, we've only won, like, 1 in the last 7 competitive games. 6 draws.
and a loss. It's really not good. But Arsenal looking good. It's still early days to see where Arsenal are going to finish, because when Arsenal, usually it starts either Arsenal go like a train on the post-January and then go down, or they start slowly, build up ahead of the team, go there like a train, and then when we get to February, Arsenal get the February blues.
Yep. Even November. Traditionally, November is always a bad month for Arsenal. And that's not far away, you know, into the Christmas period. But I think with Arsenal, I think the fact that Wenger's rotating the squad for the Europa League games, I think that's helping, because, you know, the first 11 that he brings in for the Premier League, they seem to be fresh. And that's maybe the reason why we're getting results, you know. Long may it continue. You know, who knows? This could be Arsenal's year. I hate to say it, but you know, he's going to rest the players.
Now, Frankie, you're sounding like tired.
Yeah.
I mean, next you're going to be the optimist. You're going to win the quadruple. Like, what the hell is going on here? I mean,
Chris all tired, yeah? Yeah.
Surely you don't mean for the title. You mean top four. Is that what you mean?
Even top four, I'm not sure. You know, I'm not sure of that either.
Has the top four become a trophy? So what do you mean by Arsenal yet?
I think Arsenal could they could push in the top four. The title could be beyond them. But look, if Leicester can win the league, I keep saying anything is possible.
I would totally agree with you, but I remember when Ivan Gazina said a few weeks ago that Arsenal are following the Leicester model. I remember on
the Leicester model.
Absolutely, yeah. In terms of Leicester didn't have to spend a lot of money to win the title, so therefore Arsenal are going to follow the Leicester model, not spend a lot of money and win the title. In which a lot of people absolutely insulted Gazidis, saying, listen mate, that was something that happened once every century. If you tell us Arsenal are going to follow the Leicester model, does that
Even Gazidas needs some of that Luis Ortiz medication, mate. I'll tell you that. Madness. Now, guys, let's talk about Spurs. There's one man that is absolutely on fire. That's Harry Kane, mate. A brace again. Against Huddersfield away. This man, Harry Kane, is truly a machine, Pascal.
Well, you know, there were reports coming from Spain saying that Real Madrid are potentially bidding £177 million bid for Harry Kane, you know, and
I would urge them to do so.
I mean, the problem with that is that it could potentially mean that Gareth Bale and Modric go back the other way, but, you know, which would make Spurs a much better team if that were the case. But it's saying that Harry Kane is proven to become a world-class striker. You know, he's not the most skillful, but somehow he finds himself in great positions, and his focus and his eye on goal is just quite remarkable. And once he's seen the target, he goes for it. And, you know, unlike the old Walcott, he hits the goal. He does hit the goal, you know.
Or Welbeck. Welbeck hits the pigeons, mate.
You know, the difference is this, you know, you've got players that come with promise and that develop their potential and become those players. And to me, Harry Kane is a player that, you know, that developed into the potential that he is today. And big credit to Harry Kane. It's going to be a very big credit for the England team also. The concern I have for Harry, and you will agree with me, I know it's the international week, but you know, Harry Kane and Tottenham seems to be playing such a high tempo type of football that when it comes to the international games, Harry is completely spent. He doesn't have any more energy to give to England. So whilst he's been very good for Tottenham so far, you know, I don't believe that he'll be able to replicate this form at international level, you know, simply because of the way that Tottenham play. But other than that, you know, we've got to seriously consider Harry Kane in the top five players in the world at the moment.
Top five?
Of course, with that kind of, you know, I mean, look, you think about the players like, you know, Lewandowski, Neymar, Mbappe, Messi, Ronaldo. I mean, this is a player that scores literally every week, and that doesn't score one goal, but that scores two goals, you know, and sometimes three goals, you know. It's remarkable, Frankie B. I'm sorry, but...
And you know one thing, Pascal?
Wait.
Wenger will say, I could have signed him as a professional.
He he says that all the time.
He was actually at Arsenal, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was a Gunner, yeah. Junior Gunner.
He could.
Yeah, I could have signed him. And that's what Wenger's going to say before the North London Derby, mate. I'm sure he'll say that. You know? But MJ, Spurs, you know, it seems like Spurs have got a solid back four. They've got a hard working midfield. They've got Dele Alli breaking, you know, from behind Harry Kane. Mate, they do look very well balanced as a side.
They also have Eriksen as well. You know, the interesting thing about Spurs is the fact that they don't have a lot of pace in their team when you think about it. But they actually mask that by the fact that they've got a very, very solid defence. The last two seasons, they have conceded the least goals in the Premier League. So they've got a good base in terms of Alderweireld and Vertonghen. And then in terms of that, you've got like Rose, you've got Trippier. They've got solid players in defensive areas. And this midfield, I mean, really, they do seem to have a very, very good side.
Wanyama, Dia in the midfield.
Exactly.
It's intense.
You go all the way there with players like Eriksen as well as Dele Alli. They just seem to complement themselves quite well. But however, to speak about this Harry Kane situation, Guardiola, apparently, allegedly, he muttered to himself after the game was over. He said something like, oh, you know what, the Harry Kane team, because that's what they're being known as. But, apparently Guardiola referred to Tottenham as the Harry Kane team, that the Harry Kane team are going to chase him, because he just keeps on scoring games.
Yeah.
I mean, really, I think the best thing the Premier League should do, we should just say the qualification for Champions League should only be in September. That way Harry Kane will not score and then Tottenham will make it through. Because past September, bloody hell, what a player. He's definitely going to win Player of the Month, because I think single-handedly he has been the most outstanding individual in the Premier League during the month of October. So,
do you think we're looking at the modern-day Alan Shearer?
Well, to be honest, I actually think he's actually going to eclipse Alan Shearer in terms of the
record
in the league.
Wow, his Premier League record, wow.
The reason why is because Alan Shearer played some games as pre-Premier League. He did play some games when he was in Southampton, which didn't actually make Premier League cut, I believe. So, because of that, Shearer has had a few goals kind of chopped up, because we're just talking about goals in the Premier League. And but it just seems the way Harry Kane's going now, plus Shearer played the bulk of his career in Newcastle. He always scored lots and lots of goals. But at the moment,
Blackburn, he was a problem at Blackburn.
Well,
Blackburn
as well. That's where he was actually the title winner. But majority of his career was played in an underachieving Newcastle side. He still scored a lot of goals. But if Harry Kane can remain at Spurs, if Spurs continue their upwards trajectory, because let's be real, players like Eriksen is only going to get better. He's only 23. Dele Alli, we're talking what, 2021? So he's definitely got the firepower there to actually provide him with the assist, score, and score goals. So, you know, personally, I think he's already scored over 100 goals. But in terms of his league goals, he's scored about 90 odd league goals. So he's got about 160 something odd goals to catch Alan Shearer. Now, would you put your house on the fact that he's not going to do that? I personally think he's going to catch up with that Premier League record if he stays in the Premier League, because like Pascal, I'd love to see the back of him. I'd love to see him out Real Madrid, let him go play with Cristiano Ronaldo and beat some headache. But no, awesome performance. And today's been named, he's going to be England captain, going well in terms of this international break. Because I've seen England captain doing an international break with Jordan Henderson. Harry Kane will captain England for the next few games. So yeah, I mean, all props to Harry Kane, and we just have to see how this one ends.
Yes, we will. But we'll be back again next week, talking more Premier League when it returns. But that's our time. I'd like to thank Chris Congo, Pascal, MJ and Bo. Join us again next week for another Pep Talk UK podcast. Don't forget to please hit the subscribe button and leave your comments. Thank you.
Pep Talk UK.